Hi, I'm Susan Campbell with the League of Women Voters of New Haven, and we're going to talk about affordable housing in Connecticut, and we're going to do it with help from some friends. To my left is Erica Schwartz of LISC. Would you like to tell us a little bit about LISC?
Sure. Well, LISC stands for Local Initiatives Support Corporation, and the important part about that is the local initiatives part. So our entire goal is to support groups of people in their own communities who want to make that community more affordable in a way that's appropriate for their community. So we provide technical assistance and we connect these local initiatives, these groups of people, with resources to help create affordable housing in a way that's aligned with their own goals for their own communities.
Wonderful, thank you. Next, next to Erica is Bob Fusari with HOPE. Would you like to tell us a little bit about HOPE?
Well, first I'm a builder-developer in private business, hopefully a for-profit builder, and we did build an affordable housing project in East Lyme called Sea Spray. But in my later years and semi-retirement, I've been involved with a group in Old Saybrook called the HOPE Partnership, which built 16 units of affordable housing called Ferry Crossing under the incentive housing zone. We'll be talking about that a little bit later. And that's my background in housing.
And this is your retirement?
Yes.
This is you retired, okay.
Semi-retired.
Semi. Next to Bob is Julie Savin with NeighborWorks. Can you tell us a little bit about that?
Great to be here. Yeah, NeighborWorks New Horizons was created in 1992 as an affordable housing developer. Our first project was completed in 1996 in Guilford, Connecticut. Our headquarters is in New Haven, while we have satellite offices in Bridgeport, Waterbury, and in Mystic. We have over 500 units in the state of Connecticut that we currently manage. We do both rental, affordable housing, mixed income housing, and also home ownership opportunities.
Are you all over the state, not just New Haven and here?
Except for, we do Bridgeport, but then we don't go any farther west
in Fairfield,
in Fairfield County.
Correct. Okay, thank you.
Sure.
And next to you, Terry O'Rourke with Habitat for Humanity. Most people probably know about Habitat, but please feel free.
Oh, sure. Thank you. We were founded in 87. We serve the New London County and Eastern Windham County areas. Our mission is to ensure that every man, woman, and child has a decent shelter. We've worked locally and internationally. We support tithe partners in Guatemala, Haiti, and Egypt. And we actually sent a team to Guatemala recently, which we were very excited about. Locally, we provide home ownership opportunities to low-income families making 50% or less of the median area income.
Very good, thank you. But before we start our conversation, we'd like to watch a video from HOPE Partnership.
I'm one of those people that's actually living in affordable housing. I work, I support myself. I'm finishing up my college degree.
It helped me out a lot. It gave me, gave me a roof over my head. And it gave me confidence and self-respect again.
My unit fits in this community. It doesn't stick out. It's not singled out as an affordable housing place to live.
The Connecticut shoreline is a great place to live and raise a family for those of us who can afford it. Unfortunately, fewer and fewer of us will be able to afford to buy or rent a house here. The prized quality of life on the Connecticut shoreline is in danger because affordable housing is becoming scarce. We all need to take time to learn more about the challenge we face and work towards overcoming them.
when you're fresh out of college or fresh out of technical school or any one of those things, to be able to afford a home in the town you grew up in can be a challenge.
Affordable housing lets our people who grew up in the community, who want to give back to the community, stay in the community.
So our approach, Hope's approach, is to say, let's take this problem and let's solve it ourselves. Let's put together a group of citizens that are concerned about it, that understand it, and can come up with the right place, the right location, the right design, and serve the people that they want to serve.
An ample supply of housing is critical in Connecticut to keep jobs and maintain strong neighborhoods and families. But Connecticut builders have not been producing enough housing to keep up with the need.
Builders are not generally building starter homes anymore. They're building large McMansions that are out of reach of most first-time home buyers, and there's almost no rental options on the shoreline. So we felt as a board, as an organization, that rental housing was really going to be our priority, and we would look for ways to support home ownership as well, but rental housing was something we felt was the real need.
The challenge with affordable housing is to find abutting neighbors and a community that is receptive to either incentive zone housing or affordable housing. Ferry Crossing was an example of that. The community was very accepting of that.
In 2012, a 16-unit rental community known as Ferry Crossing opened in Old Saybrook. Ferry Crossing was completed through a partnership of Hope and the Women's Institute for Housing and Economic Development on land provided by the town of Old Saybrook. It was financed by state and federal grants and a loan from the Federal Home Loan Bank. The development was designed with local architecture in mind and fits in with the current neighborhood.
Having housing that fits into the neighborhood and is well designed and looks good is something that was really, really important to Hope Partnership. And we knew that when we built something, everyone was going to be looking at it and saying that's what they're talking about. So we knew that we needed a really good architect, we needed a really good design, and we needed a really good location.
What needs to happen to make affordable housing work within the community? You need, I think primarily, to take a little bit of the stigma away. At Ferry Crossing, we have exceptional design on those buildings. I had many of my friends say to me, what are those houses going up over by Ferry Crossing, because they were interested in buying them. I think that is an important step towards getting the community to say, yeah, affordable housing is something we want here.
Hope came and put up window boxes for me. The first spring I was here, and I vowed that I would have the best looking window boxes on the street, and I do.
Well, as soon as I moved in here, I wanted to get involved in Old Saybrook, become a part of the town. When I was with Guilford, I was active for the church, had even started my own community programs, and I definitely wanted to give back. So I immediately joined the volunteer fire department here in Old Saybrook. And it's a great department. There's a lot to do. They welcomed me too.
Of the 16 units that were built here, almost half of them are people with ties to the local area. So they were people that either worked for a local employer. There's a couple folks here that work for the town, or they work for some local company, or they grew up here.
Although the situation surrounding how they came to need our help may differ, there is one common thread. They are all making the most of their opportunity for a new beginning.
I was living in Old Saybrook in a house on the sound in another part of the town, leading a very comfortable middle-class life. Excuse me, I get emotional. And my husband of 38 years fell down the stairs head first. His Medicare ran out, his supplemental insurance ran out, and I was left for for the last month of his life, I was left with a $400,000 bill.
I owned my own business. I was active in my hometown. I was a family man. I just fell in hard times. I was a veteran. And life sometimes throws curveballs.
And coming from a place where I'd owned my own home and planned everything out, and having a son that was facing possible heart surgery, that was a lot to have to think about, you know, where we're going to live. Not just to get by, but to really be successful for myself and my son. So for the people that say, not in my backyard, I'm really the girl next door. I mean, I'm the one that would be living in your backyard, and I can tell you that I'm just so thankful that the community came together to have this opportunity for so many families, because there's a lot of people that plan everything, that do everything by the book, do it correctly, and sometimes things happen in life and you find yourself in a situation where you just need another chance, and this is really what it was for us. So, and I'll forever be thankful for that.
It's a beautiful place to live. I'm very proud of it. It's a place you can be proud of. I'd say that they should take a look at what Hope is doing, because the way they plan the affordable housing, you don't know it's affordable housing. There is nothing that makes it different from any other dwelling in a community. It blends in, it doesn't stand out. They're doing a great job.
And we could say, this is what we're talking about. We're not talking about what you might think affordable housing looks like. It's high quality housing. It's the kind of housing that you or I or anyone we know would be proud to live in. And it's really, I think, created a model for how other communities, other towns like Old Sabre can do something similar. And so it really takes the wind out of the sails of somebody who says, I don't want this in my neighborhood. Because when they look at this, you can see it in their face. They think to themselves, wow, this is what they're talking about. And this is beautiful. And I would love to have something like this in my neighborhood.
The public comment at the zoning meetings has been very positive. Our zoning commission has been very receptive. And there really has been no controversy about accepting affordable housing because it's been done right. And I think with a zoning commission that is highly educated on the process, they then can communicate to the developer and to the community that this is the right thing for our community.
And to say that they're full-time workers and they can't afford to live in our area or even the surrounding area is really shame on us. We need to look at what we can provide as a community.
That was a wonderful video. Maybe now, though, is a good time to talk about what is affordable housing. Bob?
Well, by legal definition, and someone can correct me if I'm wrong here, but you should be spending no more than 30% of your income, family income, for your housing. And that includes your mortgage or rent if it's a rental, taxes if it's an ownership, utilities such as heat and lights and telephone and that sort of thing. And insurance. If it consumes more than that, then it isn't affordable. And other people here can speak to how many families are spending a lot more than 30% for their housing.
United Way just came out with the ALICE report, Asset Limited, Income Constrained, Employed. I'm so glad I remembered that. But they had some statistics that were really kind of disturbing, how many people aren't able to afford their homes, or how many the percentage of people who are living really upside down.
I think some of the statistics include about 40% of households throughout the state of Connecticut are spending more than the 30% that Bob referred to, more than 30% of their income. And of that, I think about 24% of people throughout the state are actually spending 50% or more of their income towards their housing costs. So it leaves very little left for living, for food, for school. And it causes a lot of stress in families.
Big time. And we talked before the show started, we were talking about the impact on families and how if Connecticut is not affordable, where do these people go?
where are they living? Or we talked about affordable, but not necessarily where you'd want to live.
Well, that's an interesting thing. That's how Hope Partnership got started. One of the local churches had an after-school program for students, and they found that some of those students really didn't have a home. They were living in motels, and they were in this program because their parents were working. These were not just folks who were having problems with a job. They had jobs, but they weren't earning enough to be able to rent or buy in Old Saybrook or any of the surrounding towns. They lived in motels for most of the year, and then during the tourist season, they lived in tents or some other accommodations, perhaps with relatives or friends, for the summer season, then back to motels again. And that's when Hope got started and said, that's wrong, and we really want to do something about it. I wasn't part of Hope at that time, but I was invited to be part of that effort about a year later.
So that they were effectively homeless.
Legally, they were homeless.
Yeah.
There's a rather lengthy definition of what homelessness is, but yes, they were homeless. Didn't have an address that they could get mail at.
Hmm.
And for our families, they live in a lot of subsidized housing, federally or locally subsidized housing. And for us, it's unfair to make a sweeping remark about the quality of subsidized housing, but for the families that we work with, because one of our selection criteria is a demonstrated need, and you're usually looking for physical defects, families are living in homes that are either heavily infected with mold or structurally or just not well kept. And almost all of the families we've selected for our partnership program since 2007 have members of their family living with asthma as a result of their housing. So I think the quality of our housing, if it is affordable, it's made affordable with public funds, and it also may be unhealthy.
The folks that, to expound on what Terry was saying, there is that working poor, and even if they're not in subsidized housing, the only thing affordable to them is substandard housing. And it does lead to reduced attendance in school. It leads to unhealthy. When we have people who live in substandard housing, they have more health problems. So there's that, and then it's also difficult to sometimes maintain a job. So when one makes $8.70 an hour, that's only $18,096 a year. But the fair market rent for a one bedroom is $788. So that one person, that household or one person who lives there is going to have 1.5 jobs. And that's if they work 40 hours a week and 52 weeks a year. If that household needs two bedrooms, that's $1,035. So with these really low incomes, minimum wage in particular, people cannot afford standard housing, standardized housing, or anything very nice. So they are living in areas that all they can afford is something that's not very healthy. And talking about healthy housing is very important.
Go ahead, I'm sorry.
And I wanted to just add one more point when we were talking about what is affordable housing. And all of us here, the three nonprofit developer groups and LISC, we work with a lot of groups who are creating privately owned nonprofit affordable housing. And I think sometimes people confuse all the different types of housing. There's public housing that's fully publicly funded and publicly managed. There's a lot of great public housing. There's also some public housing that's not so great. But what we're talking about is, for the most part, I think, when private nonprofit organizations, mostly it's nonprofits, are creating housing, from LISC's perspective anyway, that's really locally controlled and created by an organization that has a mission to do that, with a goal of making something that's so fantastic that you can't tell if that's affordable housing or not. And the best affordable housing, you don't know it's affordable because it seamlessly blends in with the community where it is.
And this might be a good time to go to some photos to look at some of the affordable housing. That video certainly showed houses that you would not drive by and go, that's affordable. Some of these photos, Bob, do you recognize
them? Those are photos of Ferry Crossing that you're looking at right now in Old Saybrook. 16 units, I think it was explained in the video. One of the myths that goes along with affordable housing is that it's going to fill up the schools. Well, number one, every kid who's 6 years or 5 years or older is going to be in a school someplace. We don't make them just because we build them housing. They're here, they're someplace, and they're all in school, at least most of the time. Mm-hmm. What we want them to be there is to be there all the time and to live in a decent community and a decent decent home. And that's what Ferry Crossing and others have accomplished. And who are the people who live there? You saw in the video a little bit of a cross-section, and it's really our sons and our daughters, my grandkids, your mm-hmm. grandkids, people who are earning a good living, not necessarily minimum wage, but well above that, $30,000, $35,000, $40,000 a year. You can't buy anything in these communities at that income level, and that's not $8 an hour. I mean, that's a decent wage. And so that's what we're meant to do. What we're trying to do is to get people who are moving out of the state to find affordable housing to be able to stay here.
And that the snippet of a video was taken on an affordable housing bus tour, Julie?
Correct. The Southeastern Connecticut Housing Alliance sponsored a bus tour on December 12th, 2014, so just about a week ago. Mm-hmm. And we had about 40 riders, and they represented many towns in the area, for us to go look at affordable housing in Southeastern Connecticut. And the HOPE Partnership Project was one of the stops that we made. It was sponsored by Liberty Bank Foundation, which is a huge supporter of affordable housing and the concept of better housing for folks in the area and in the state. And we went to see, I think, about 7 locations.
Yep.
And spent Terry half a day. Too. We had. Yeah, Terry was there too. Terry provided the coffee and donuts. But we did also have folks, First Selectmen, we had some zoning, we had a very great cross-section of people interested to see what does affordable housing look like. And affordable housing looks like everyone's housing.
But is that a tough road to hoe to convince people of that? When people hear affordable housing, they often have something entirely different in mind.
Absolutely, absolutely. They're thinking of the old school warehousing, mm-hmm. okay? They're thinking about brick buildings that look like prisons with a lot of crime. Affordable housing shouldn't look like that anymore. And we are, as a collective, moving to change what affordable housing looks like, because people are living together. We do mixed income housing, so we have people who can earn 6 figures living next to someone who maybe makes $30,000 a year. Bringing people together. Everyone has something to learn from somebody else, whether you make a lot of money or you don't. Mm-hmm. So we believe in bringing people together and not finding a place to put people who are low wage earners.
And go ahead.
And I think We're seeing this trend also at LISC. We help local groups across the whole state, and that ranges from Cornwall and Litchfield to down in this area of the state where we are now. We're sitting in Groton, but we've helped groups in surrounding communities. We're in Fairfield County helping groups in Ridgefield and even in some of the bigger cities. To Putnam in the northeastern part of the state, there are small groups of people throughout the entire state wanting to make their communities more affordable. LISC has been doing work in Connecticut for 30 years, and in that time we've invested in over 4,000 units of affordable housing throughout the state. Many of them have been created by established nonprofit organizations like the ones I'm sitting with here, but a lot of them have come from small groups of volunteers in their community who get together and they have an idea, they want to make their community affordable, so young families don't have to leave, so maybe young families can come in, so seniors can afford to stay, and they're not sure what to do, and that's where LISC can really come in. So I guess I'm appealing to anyone out there, if you are an individual or a group thinking, you know, my community could use something like what we've been seeing on the screen, LISC provides that assistance to help you understand what are the next steps, how do I connect with professionals, because this is technical stuff to build housing. How do I connect with those resources to make that happen in my community?
I'm going to get the number wrong, but isn't Connecticut like the 6th or 4th oldest state for our median age? And people are aging in Connecticut, so people like me want to downsize. But we can't necessarily do that in the towns we raised our children because housing prices have gone through the roof.
We're aging for 2 reasons. One, we're really aging, like myself. But the other is, when you do the statistics, you find that the younger people are moving out. Yeah. So the percentage of older people in Connecticut is increasing dramatically, because we're staying here and without a place to go, except for the few who may end up in the snowbirds who end up in mm-hmm. Florida and the other ones. But that statistic is getting alarming because who's going to support us? I guess it's the
Erica.
Erica.
Thanks.
But we laugh at that. But when our kids have gone to North Carolina or Idaho or some other place where they can't afford to live, they're no longer here doing what a dynamic and eclectic community should do. Mm-hmm.
And they take their babies with them.
Yeah.
So our school enrollment is declining almost across the board.
Yeah.
Every single town is experiencing decreased enrollment.
So when people worry that, oh, this is adding too much to the schools in fact are emptying out
they
at
sure
the same
are.
Time. So
plus, the development of affordable housing can achieve a big economic impact in targeted areas. Like, there are different towns that have very significantly depressed areas in their, within their own jurisdiction. And if you get a couple of developers together of all levels of income targeting, you can actually dramatically impact a targeted area. And home ownership, which we advocate for, creates a vested citizen, somebody who's going to be a stakeholder in that community. We have an acre and a quarter that we're going to develop in Norwich. We hope it's 7 to 10 households that we can put in that neighborhood. Well, that's a huge influx of new homeowners in one very small area. The people that are there, they are aging. They are the advocates for trying to keep their neighborhood healthy and vibrant, and they encourage this kind of development. And so anytime we collectively can work together, and that's the other thing we want to appeal to, is having different organizations target a specific area within to work, because if you work collaboratively on it, you can change an area. It happens in New London, where Hope, a different Hope, is building on one street that's been a blighted street for a long time, and one by one she's bought the properties and renovated them at an extremely high standard. You talk about affordable housing, these houses have fiberboard cement siding, which is extremely durable. They have solid surface countertops inside, whether they're granite or whatever. I mean, that's not affordable for Habitat, but it doesn't fit in our spectrum, but all of our homes are built today by very strict standards that require them to be energy efficient. I mean, that's not an option today. If you're building new, you're building quality. You have to. It's built into the code enforcements. And you don't get permits to move past something if you don't do it the right way. If you're receiving any kind of government money, you're also building to their standards, which is a visitable home, which means it has to be accessible. You have to be able to age in place.
Mm-hmm.
These kind of designs are part of today's investment in affordable housing. I think so. Between trying to target and affecting a geographic area, and then who you're actually working with to build the homes, you're building a quality product. So in terms of people looking at what affordable is and being ashamed of it, it doesn't exist today.
And we're very fortunate because the mayors and the first selectmen of a lot of our towns, especially in southeastern Connecticut, are getting it.
Really?
It's really wonderful. It's refreshing. 10 years ago, I could not have said that. I think even 5 years ago, I could not have said that.
So what
But
changed?
We do a lot of outreach, and we do a lot of sort of behind the scenes, even if we're not doing a project in the town. It's about educating, and it's about showing the bus tour. It's about doing things like that. But it's finally getting some of the decision makers on board to understand that's beautiful. And we do have people in our town that serve me coffee every morning, that serve me dinner, that work at the bank, that's a teacher right out of college, it's a fireman. And those folks all need proper housing. And so they're getting it from another angle. They're getting it from their constituents, finally. Mm-hmm. You know, not just us and not the grassroots or groups, especially some that like LISC will work with. You know, those folks are powerful. But finally putting a face to the need is helping our decision makers.
The thing that made Hope work in Old Saybrook was the outreach that the Hope organization did to all of the people. I mean, not every single individual, but all of the groups in town. The business community, the faith community, the public institutions such as the schools, the Board of Education, the fire department, the EMTs. The first selectman was very much on board. The selectman at that time, not the one you saw on the screen, he's also a supporter, but it was a different selectman that was around at that time. And we had 7 public hearings to get the approval from the various agencies, all unanimous with no opposition in any of the public hearings. And a town meeting so that they could approve leasing the land, the town leasing the land to Hope, unanimous approval. I've been a builder for 60 years. I've been to countless public hearings on my own projects. I've watched other developers while my project was there for approval. Nothing I've seen nothing like this in my entire experience. There's always significant opposition. Sure. But if you do your homework so people understand it and know exactly what it is and how it's good for the community and why they should support it, they do. They really do. And it would be extremely difficult for a commission to turn it down as long as you've met all of the regulations that go along with it. The hardest thing to do is to find a site to do this on. That is the most difficult job, I believe, second only to getting the public to support you.
And I think more and more, though, even municipal level people are interested in this. Right now, LISC has been providing some light technical assistance to Newington, not in the immediate area, but not a huge city, where they have an affordable housing committee that's been charged with studying the needs. And we provided them with some templates and samples of housing needs surveys that they've been able to tweak and really make their own for what they wanted to ask, and that study is now underway in Newington. The town of Stonington was going to be doing their town's consolidated plan, as they have to do, but this time they decided they wanted to include an affordable housing component specifically, and LISC was able to provide them with resources so they could get a professional to create a well-done affordable housing plan. And now that town has an affordable housing committee looking at the issue. So I think there is often still opposition. But luckily, even at municipal levels, like both of you have been saying, people are understanding. And I think the trend is moving in the right direction.
You mentioned mixed income. How does that work? You have a developer come in and say, I want to build 16 units. Mm-hmm. How many have to be affordable to be considered mixed income?
As many as you want.
Okay.
But it's also dictated, too, by the funding you're pursuing. So, for instance, a lot of the funding at the state level is point-based, and you get so many points for a certain target level. 25% AMI, 50% AMI, 60% AMI.
AMI
being area median income. The
good
acronym
job.
World.
And HUD sets those every year.
Yes.
So family.
And
year.
HUD is?
Yeah.
Our federal Department of Housing and Urban Development sets these income limits every year that sometimes they shift a little bit, but that's what everyone uses, that same standard.
Yeah, and they do it for every metropolitan statistical area in the country, not just us here. People seem to forget that. The locale also makes a determination, the need, the community need, the town's need, and whether you're doing homeownership or rental. Mm-hmm. So there's a lot of variables that go into determining whether or not you want to, what income level you're going to serve. But mixed income for us, because when we first started out in 1992, affordable housing was 100% affordable. And we've learned a lesson, and I think a lot of us nonprofit developers have learned that lesson. That, again, I know I said it before, but it's really important to understand that people learn from each other. And so having that, those, they become your future stakeholders. You know, these are stakeholders in the community. Their kids go to the schools, they work hopefully in town or maybe in the nearby town. And if they're owning that unit, now they are taking care of all of that. So I think that mixed income is a valuable tool when you're doing affordable housing.
Well, I think it's a critical part. I think we've all learned that if you concentrate one economic group into a very small area, it doesn't provide for the best investment. It probably doesn't provide for the learning experiences that we're talking about. But, I mean, I've heard people discuss some sort of tax incentives to try to help encourage a wider variety of economic groups living in a community. It is what makes a community. It's that variety of education and income and all the demographics you can talk about. But variety is the most important part of a healthy community. So to me, I'd like to see us as a state look at some sort of tax incentives. Came up at one of the CECHA community meetings that helps promote ownership or rental. It has a big strategic plan that you take an overarching view of, you know, we want so many affordable housing units, we want so many moderate income units, we want some affluent income units. It needs all of that in order to create the vibrancy of a community.
Right. People think that diversity means the color of your skin. Mm-hmm. And sure, that's a component. But economic diversity is so valuable. And we don't intuitively think about that. We have to stop and remind ourselves. I think Terry and I probably do it intuitively now, but it's the economic diversity is just as important.
I can address that a little bit. One of the communities that we visited on the bus tour was our community. Meaning our company, not Hope, but our company built in East Lyme called Seaspray. And it's 108 units of townhouse and flat condominiums. 30% of that project is affordable by definition, deed restricted. It's built under one of the regulations called 830G, laws called 830-G, I believe it is. Mm-hmm. And what that says is if a developer meets certain standards, and that is, I think you're seeing it on the screen right now, meets a 30% of the project affordable, meaning 15% at 80% of median income and 15% at 60% of median income or below, then I don't want to use the word violate, but I can overlook some of the zoning regulations, such as setback, and I can't change safety and health regulations, those or environmental regs, but I can do some things that the zoning might not otherwise allow in order to keep that cost down. I can get higher density. And that's what allows me as a private developer, hopefully a for-profit developer, to be able to still make a profit on a project, even though I'm selling units, some of them at below my cost. The 60% of median income units went for about $105,000 when we were building these about six, seven years ago. That was below my bare cost. Yeah. But I made it up on the fact that I got more units on this site than I would have otherwise been able to get. It's a great community. I think invite anybody to go look at it. The affordable units are mixed into the rest of the project, and they are identical in every way except maybe upgrades that the people who paid market rate bought some granite countertops and maybe had the loft room finished into a bedroom. But other than that, the units are identical. And if you went out there today and said, well, I think that's an affordable unit, you're taking a wild guess. You have no way to be able to know that. We enjoyed it as a builder, and if the builder is watching this, I would encourage you to look into it. There's an even better program called the Incentive Housing Zone, which came on board about 5 years ago. The downturn in the market has kept us from doing much to address that, but Ferry Crossing was built under the Incentive Housing Zone.
Can you explain what that is?
Yeah, and that means that a builder, be it private or nonprofit, at least 20% of the project has to be affordable by families making 80% of median income or less. Don't get confused with all those percentages. They're hard to remember. But it makes it a little more feasible for a private developer to make a project pencil out and work and get financing on. That you're going to see more and more of. It also carries with it, requires that the town adopt design standards and that the developer comply with those design standards. Ferry Crossing is an example of that. What you see at Ferry Crossing is because there were proscriptive design standards going in, and you knew what you had to do. And that's why you see what you see.
It's interesting because you're saying the town itself sets the design standards, and you've brought up local control basically several times, that this is not where the legislators in Hartford are telling you have to do this. People maintain local control, which is a big deal if
exactly.
You're talking about affordable housing.
Right. And there's a lot of tools that municipalities can use. You know, one thing that's even a little more proactive is inclusionary zoning or creating a housing trust. And a lot of communities have chosen to go that route where for inclusionary zoning, there might be a requirement that a market rate developer has to put in exchange for something like density. You can't just kind of tax someone for no reason, but in exchange for a benefit, such as perhaps a little bit more density, that developer must include affordable units or make a cash payment to a fund. And if it's a cash payment to a fund, then that town has money to go and develop affordable housing or find a great nonprofit partner and develop affordable housing in their community. And certainly LISC's whole focus is making sure that we're not applying some standard to a community, but that each community can decide for itself. You know, in Connecticut and in New England, we're very concerned about our local places, and we want to retain the beauty and the heritage and the culture we have. And affordable housing can fit with that as long as the people who are in their community are making those decisions. So we support that.
But there are some municipalities with 0.2% mm-hmm. affordable homes.
And they're okay with it.
They're okay with it. How are you going to reach them? And I interrupted. Did you start to say something, Terry?
I would want to comment on just creative ways that different local municipalities have worked to try to create affordable housing. Like the town of Lyme has a nonprofit it formed called the Lyme Compact, and their goal is to create affordable home ownership in the town of Lyme. Now, everybody can look at it and say, okay, the town of Lyme, being a very affluent town in our area, but they recognize they've got teachers and firemen that live there, and so they've partnered with Habitat on a couple of properties where the nonprofit finds the land, and then they work with an affordable housing developer, and they lease the land to the occupant, to the owner of the house. So the home improvement is sold, so the house is the improvement to the land, and they lease the land to the owner for 99 years with a 99-year option. And that makes it affordable to be in a town where land would normally not be affordable for an affordable developer. So I think it was a very creative way to try to improve their housing stock at the same time bring some diversity.
And that's also called a land trust model, so people could
right.
look that up online and learn about it. I've often wondered why that kind of a model isn't more popular, because especially in very expensive places, it can work really well.
I think the question of what does it take to convince people they need it, when they find that they're going to have a paid fire department and what the real cost of that is. Mm-hmm. If you can't find volunteers for a fire department, the cost of having a paid department is astronomical, particularly in a smaller town. We have to divide it by fewer taxpayers. And that's what gave the first selectman in Old Sabre the motivation to begin to look at this simultaneous, not together in the beginning, but simultaneous with the Hope's partnership efforts. He found that if he could get the right number of volunteers, he was going to have a paid fire department. That moves a lot of people. And I think there are a lot of towns that fall right into that category. And then there's the, what happens? Why don't we have these folks? Where are the kids, where are the coaches that are going to run up and down the field? Coaches today in the small towns get a little aged, and running up and down a soccer field with the kids isn't something that maybe is the healthiest thing for them. So they really need the younger people. The site that the Ferry Crossing project is built on was originally earmarked for recreation. Hmm. And to get the Park and Rec people to give up part of that site, you saw the soccer field as part of it, it wasn't easy, but once they realized there was a benefit to that, that maybe some of the coaches would live in that place, they'd stay in town, and they could really do the job that the Park and Rec people, they bought into it. And it was, as I said, we had no opposition, support from virtually every town agency.
That's amazing, because you don't. Did you start to say something, Julie, when
no.
I was?
No.
Want to say anything? So if you convince people that it's good for everyone, including themselves, because we were talking earlier about you do things out of a selfish motivation, even when you're doing something nice. In the case of you and I would like for my grandchildren to be able to purchase homes in Connecticut and stay here. You said you don't want to travel to California to see your grandchildren
right.
who have to move out to, probably not California, that's pretty expensive, Arkansas, but you don't want to have to fly to go see your family.
Yeah. I also want them to be able to enjoy what I did when I was their age. Mm. I bought a house when I was 23 years old and married. Today's kids coming out of college with a good education and a job, perhaps a job opportunity, two incomes, can't do that. There's something wrong here. There's something really, really wrong. Where have we gone in 50, 60 years?
There's an organization, National Low Income Housing, and they do a housing wage study every year. Correct me if I'm wrong.
But it's called Out of Reach.
Out of Reach. And Connecticut's is $23.22. A worker has to make $23.22 an hour to afford a decent two-bedroom apartment.
To rent.
Yeah, to rent.
If I could comment on what is on the screen now, that's the Seaside condo project in East Lyme, the Niantic, right a block away from the beach. And NeighborWorks New Horizons is the affordable housing administrator. These condos were built under the 8-30G Connecticut state statute that Bob spoke to earlier. And they have condos that are set aside for folks who are 60% of the area median income as well as 80% of the area median income, right next door to market rate units that could be as high as $500,000. They've got 1, 2, and 3 bedroom units. It's adorable setting, and they're just starting their second phase.
And there's no age restriction there?
No age restriction at all.
Are there deed restrictions?
Deed restriction. Under the 830G, you are required to file a deed restriction.
And can you
explain that?
And that
is for 40 years. So those units that are set aside at 60% and 80% of the area median income, which is 30% of that project, has to be affordable. Those units have to be affordable for 40 years.
So if I buy there, buy one of the affordable units and I want to sell it, it has to be sold?
That person who is going to buy from you has to come to me to get approved. And
by
that person
income.
Will sell it, and they'll still have to get approval for 40 years. We have to ensure to the state of Connecticut and to the town of East Lyme that that new buyer fits the criteria of 830G.
Because if they don't, then you run the risk of getting all this money, not you, but the developer runs the risk. They could get all this money to buy affordable that could then flip to market rate.
Right, and that's essentially what the state statute is trying to prevent. They want it to remain affordable for long term. We don't want someone to go in there and buy it for a really nice price and then turn around and sell it for a lot of money.
Yeah.
That sale of that condo is, there's a formula that's actually prescribed within 830G that determines what the sale of that condo is going to be at any point in time. And it is based on current income levels. So we take into account many different things in order to qualify someone. There's two tests, I always say, when you're looking at affordable housing, generally speaking, rental or homeownership, you have to fall under the income limit that the federal government has determined that we spoke to earlier, and also they can't spend more than 30% of their household income, including their mortgage or their rent, and that's what makes it affordable.
And I think there's a couple benefits to the deed restriction. There's two. One is, you know, as we've kind of alluded to, it's not any cheaper to create an affordable unit than a market rate unit. It's just going to be rented or sold at a lower price. So between that market price and what you're going to rent it or sell it to a family that can afford it, you have to fill that with subsidy that is most often public subsidy. And so it's a protection of our public investment in this affordable housing that all of these affordable units are deed restricted to stay affordable. So we're investing public money and we get that benefit over time. And then of course, just the second benefit is that the unit stays affordable. We all know that housing markets can be unpredictable. They can shoot up really quickly in areas that have long been expensive. Even the downfall in our housing market did not make a place, you know, like Fairfield, just as an example, or other, you know, maybe Lyme, affordable. And so we get the protection of our public investment, and we also get that unit that's going to be affordable for maybe generations of families who need that price that they can afford.
I'd like to make one thing clear, though. In our project, Sea Spray, there was absolutely no state or federal money in that
really.
Project at all. That gap that you talked about that was made up between actual cost and the price you saw, particularly the 60% of median income, is made up by the fact that we got something extra in that project that we wouldn't have had if we hadn't put that affordable component in there. We would not have got 108 units. And the numbers worked out that work for us. All of them don't work. I mean, you can't, every project you look at isn't necessarily one that will pencil out. And if there are builders watching this, it's worth your while to take a good look at it. But you don't have to put up with the bureaucracy that goes with tapping those dollars. Mm-hmm. A nonprofit can do it because you're going to have a larger component of your project, typically, than 30% that's going to be affordable. But for a private developer who wants to stay away from that bureaucratic issue, it can be done. You just got to make sure you get enough of the benefits that can offset the, that component. You've done a favor for yourself to be able to build something that's profitable. You've done a favor for your community and maybe for your kids or your grandkids.
So this is a League of Women Voters program. One last thing, anything to say to people out there who've watched this? We've changed their minds. Who should they?
This property that we're looking at right now is Davis Farm in New London, and it's six single-family homes. All the families were 50% or less of the median income. I guess I'd like to just point out a couple of things. One of the things that's famous in the world of affordable housing as not wanting it in my backyard is that families don't take care of their houses. Well, that Davis Farm shot, these house shots, the units that Bob showed us, all of them show very well. They show no better or worse than what you would expect any homeowner to take care of their house. All of the families have a vestment in that home. They've worked on it to help build it. They feel like they have a big stake in it. They've spent a lot of time learning how to maintain homes. I think the public should understand not only are we building quality homes, but the families who are having the opportunity to purchase them or rent them appreciate the opportunity, and just as much as you would see in the public's, in the normal population, you would see families taking care of their properties just as well as your neighbor.
Absolutely. As I'd started to say, this is a League of Women Voters show. What do you tell people out there about affordable housing? If they're suddenly now they think, okay, well, maybe this is a pretty good idea, who should they start with?
Erica? Well, they could definitely contact LISC if they go to lisc.org and get in touch with our office. We are always happy to talk to anyone. We drive literally all over the entire state, so this show will only reach a certain area, but if you're watching this show, we will come to you and talk to you. If you have any questions, we can help you think about how to advance affordable housing in your community.
I would say just get involved. Get out of your easy chair and do something. Go out to your website, the Partnership for Strong Communities. All the information you ever want to know, the real, honest to goodness, genuine facts, are a couple of clicks away. Partnership for Strong Communities. Google it, and you'll learn everything you want to know. And be an expert on it. So when you talk to your neighbors, you talk to your friends, you're at a gathering, you have the facts, because they don't. And when you have the facts, you're in command, but get involved. And get your friends, get your relatives, get your kids, whose ox is being gored by this. Get them involved. And that's my speech, my soapbox for today.
Very good.
I would say two major players here, your local mayor, first selectman, or city manager. They're all starting to get it, slowly but surely, some more than the others. And also, there's a new department at the state level that's called the Department of Housing, and they have a website, the Connecticut State Department of Housing. They've got wonderful personnel. I would suggest you reach out to them. You can find all kinds of things about funding, partners, developers, all kinds of sources, and I would definitely go there.
Wonderful. Terry?
I would just say, for anybody who wants to be in the political forum, the homeowners and renters are your stakeholders, and if they're vested in their properties, they're likely to be engaged in the politics or in voting. So, to tie both those things together is to say, bring more home ownership into the picture and you'll end up having a better community because you have better stakeholders.
People who are vested. I think we have time for one more group of pictures of city flats.
This is kind of cool. It's part of something big that's happening as a result of the foreclosure crisis is that there's a lot of vacant property, a lot of buildings that exist, and this developer is working in downtown New London. I mean, that's just beautiful work, seeing him renovate a particular area around an area he's already developed. So it's just nice to see.
Yes, and he's naturally pricing some of those condos at a lower price. They're not deed restricted. No one's forcing him to do it. Oh. He just sees the need and he sees the marketability.
Wonderful. Well, I think we're about to run out of time, so I would like to thank the panelists, Erica, Bob, Julie, and Terry for their time, and thank you for watching.
Our pleasure.
And we hope you learned something. Thank you very much.
My name is Mary Ellen Doblecki. There are three reasons why I joined the men and women of the League of Women Voters. The League is one of the oldest and continually active organizations in the United States that protects voter rights. It is an organization that encourages members to research and advocate on issues that affect every citizen's life. Secondly, as a member of this group, I have learned to organize forums, debates, and community meetings to educate citizens on a variety of topics. I've learned to run voter education projects and voter registration drives. Were I a young person, these league activities would provide a fabulous resume. Lastly, the men and women of the league have a voice on many issues, such as those that affect our natural resources, gun safety, children's education, and most importantly, the frequently challenged issue of voter rights. Join us.